and welcome to Luzhou for finals day at the Li Ning BWF World Super Series Finals. The end of season championships for the top eight players in each of the five disciplines as determined from the 12 tournament which make up the OSIM BWF World Super Series. And there you can see the whole list of the 12 tournaments. Well, for the first 3 days, the players battled it out in a group round-robin section. The top two from those groups then qualified for the knockout stage, the semi-finals yesterday. Today, as I say, is finals day, and there's the list of our top speeds of smashes so far in the tournament. 2.88 from Zhu Chen in the mixed doubles. He achieved that yesterday in the semi-final for the women. Wang Xiaoli and Yu Yang, well, they'll be first match on court because they are the defending champions in the women's doubles. Our order of play, as you can see, we're starting with women's doubles, then mixed, then men's doubles, women's singles and men's singles to finish off. The first three matches feature defending champions, and it's only the men's doubles that doesn't feature current world champions, so that really is an indication of the level of play here this week in Luzhou. So women's doubles with the world number ones, world champions, then mixed doubles, Zhang and Zhao, world champions in the mixed doubles against the number two ranked pair in the world, their compatriots. Then Bo and Mogensen against Chai Biao and Guo Zhengdong. Then women's doubles and the world number one and world champion Wang Yihan up against Sina Nei. Well, what a tournament she's had. She's defeated Wang Xin from China and Tina Baun yesterday in the semi-final. And then the last match, the men's singles, Lin Dan, the world and Olympic champion, against Chen Wong, who put out the world number one Li Chongwei of Malaysia yesterday. Well, I'm Jill Clark, sitting alongside Ian Wright, and Ian, it really has been a fabulous week here in Luzhou.
Yes, it's been really interesting seeing the top players from around the world coming together for this event, end of the season, culmination of the Super Series year. What's been really interesting for me has been the how they've coped with the different format with the pool play. It threw up some really interesting scenarios and under a slightly different type of pressure, and I think it's been a really good week's badminton.
Yes, it certainly has. But as far as Wang Xiaoli and Yu Yang are concerned, undefeated so far in this year's tournament. And it's interesting, the group format around robin, two groups of four in each of the five disciplines, of course, because it means that the women's doubles final is a repeat of a match that happened earlier in the week, because both of these pairs are from Group A. And what's even more interesting as we watch Chinese world number ones come onto court is that their opponents, led out by Ha Zhenglong and Kim Mingzhu, there's Ha, is the fact that in their group they only won one match, two losses, qualified in second place behind their opponents of today. Then in their semi-final, beat the Danes Christina Pedersen and Camilla Rutil in two straight games, which means that they've battled their way through to the tournament, even though they lost to the Hong Kong pair, and also obviously lost to their opponents of today in the group section. And that's one of the beauties, I guess, of round robin group play, is that you can suffer a loss and still come back and win. Normally, of course, badminton only knockout, and that's the beauty and the harshness, I suppose, of knockout competition. Well, this format means that we have been able to witness match after match of the very, very highest quality. Well, there is Yu Yang, the current Olympic champion, 25-year-old from Haicheng in Liaoning province, and her partner, 22-year-old Wang Xiaoli. Chinese pair formed their partnership straight after the World Championships last year in Paris, where they played against each other in the final. both those partnerships were promptly split, and they teamed up together, and since then it's been quite remarkable. Look at that, only three losses, once when they got injured, and just two other losses, once when they retired halfway through the China Masters final, and then the other time was the first Super Series tournament of the year. They lost in the final of the Malaysian to their teammates Jiang Qing and Zhao Yunlei. So quite clearly number one in the world, 58-2 for the year. And this, their 13th final of the year, from 13 tournaments played. That's not bad going, is it? Maybe you can safely say they justify their number one ranking. So to their opponents, they're Kim Min-jul, 25 years of age, and they're number four in the world ranking and qualified for the Super Series finals as number four on the Super Series list. And their win-loss record for the year translates into this being their sixth final of 2011. In the previous five, they won three of them, but all of them Grand Prix events. Only one final in Super Series events this year for Ha and Kim, and that was the Singapore Super Series, and they lost out to another Chinese pair, Qian Qing and Zhao Yunlei. Ha, who was a semi-finalist last year in the mixed doubles. This is the first time that they have qualified as a pair for Super Series finals, Ha and Kim. Greg Velikots, Arampa, Gosi Yang from Malaysia, service judge.
Korea, and on my left, Yu Yang and Wang Xiaoli, China.
Oh, good crowd in already. And I can see many more spectators finding their way into this brand new arena.
Level in China.
For the first of our 2011 Super Series finals. Gets underway. And this, of course, is the sixth meeting between these two pairs. Last time was 2 days ago on Friday when they played each other in the group section. A couple of days ago, two straight games, 21-15, 21-9. But the ominous thing for all Korean fans is in their five previous meetings, they've yet to register a victory, but they have gone to three games a couple of times in, so you know, they've proved that they're getting closer, although I thought Friday's second game was disappointing.
Yes, they've had an up and down week, really, the Korean pair. They've been a little bit inconsistent, but I'm sure in this final the coaches have been talking to them, trying to get them on court to play free, to be aggressive, try and break the rhythm of the Chinese pair. Which, as you say, just at times of a couple of matches this year, we've seen that they've been able to do that by using good variety, using good width in the rear court, keeping Yu Yang off the net position. So they know what to do. It's just a question of whether they can execute on the day. It's a little bit short. You can see the tactic is there, trying to move, keep Yu Yang off that net position and try and move her laterally in the rear court. Wang Xiaoli was up to the task, stepped out, good interception.
Of course, Yu Yang and Wang Xiaoli will be very fresh. They didn't have to play a semi-final yesterday because they were given a walkover by their teammates Tian Qing and Zhao Yunlei.
That's good play.
I'm never quite sure, Ian, whether it's good to have a rest or whether it's better for players to have one match, get used to the stadium and the arena, because from semi-finals onwards, the configuration of the stadium here did change, because they went from two courts down to one court, and the one court was moved to the very centre of the arena, and one or two players had been looking up at the lights and obviously feeling conditions were a bit different yesterday.
Yeah, it's been a long year. I'm not sure that the Chinese will be too bothered. I'm sure they had a good workout in the training hall yesterday. What I do think is it may be a slight advantage for the Koreans. They've got the confidence. They had a mixed performance in the pool stages, but they came out and played a very positive semi-final yesterday. So I'm sure they'll have taken a little bit of confidence from that performance yesterday.
Yeah.
Seeing the chance, getting in, not giving Yu Yang time to settle on that net position, getting in early and pushing the shuttle past her, putting the pressure on Wang Xiaoli in the rear court. Good tactics. Rally in the game, tactically sound. Wang Xiaoli in the rear court, Yu Yang looking for interceptions, but the Koreans were very careful to keep her out of the game there. Keep pushing past her, not giving Yu Yang the chance to intercept on that front court position. That's when she does, that's what happens.
And of course, we know. One excellent mixed doubles player she's been as well, and a big bronze medalist in Beijing with He Hanbin. Silver medalist at last year's World Championships in mixed doubles.
Position, there's actually space. We'll see. She's out. She wants to intercept, but it was a good defensive shot. And Kim fails to use the space she's created.
Service over. 5-7.
Good again. Good return. The Koreans will know how dangerous Chinese pair are when Yu Yang's serving. Concerted effort there to push past her, not let her intercept the third shot. Interception on the front court. Can shuttle above the net. They can't afford to do that against this pair. They need to take their chances.
Oh, nice play. Very nice play from Wang Xiaoli. We've seen the prizes of Yu Yang at the front of the court. Wang Xiaoli's no slouch either, is she?
No, she's a very complete player these days. Just as comfortable in the front court as the rear court. Yeah, good defense from the Koreans again. Service using good width to Yu Yang. She's in the rear court. Nine. We see that Wang Xiaoli wanting to rotate, wanting to give Yu Yang the opportunity to get in. So that leaves a lot of space.
Ball!
being really determined to hit the shuttle down. Good use of the mid-court area. Channel attack. Forces the error.
There's something to work with, isn't there? I mean, they're getting into the rallies, they're not being losing quick points, they're not being totally dominated, they're working their way into the rallies.
When you come in the first place, you're in a low situation,
then you've got something to work with as a coach. If they were losing 3-4 shot rallies, then that's more of a problem.
Advantage. 11-6 opening game. Committed to a forehand defence, just aimed slightly across the body. Perfect placement.
Defense from the Koreans, Wang Xiaoli chaining together a number of smashes there. The Korean defense was up to it. In the end, Chinese opting to go on counter-attack on defense. Again, the Koreans created the opportunity, just couldn't execute the finish.
Oh my goodness, Wang Xiaoli had to work so hard at the start of that rally. Yeah, all four athletes breathing heavily, feeling the pace of that. Good judgment.
It's an unusual error. I don't see that very often. Yang serving out, direct fault. Oh, that's a little bit wild.
8-14.
Lee there. She's a good all-court player, but she does prefer to be in the rear court, I think, and there, just an example. Just too big a swing, really, in the forecourt there. Lost control of the shuttle, mistimed it. Oh, great defense.
Just wide.
Again, Koreans working hard, keeping the attack. Just the final shot going awry again. Worked the opening, it was on. The angled smash down the line. Would have been a winner. Just missed.
Oh, terrible indecision at the back of the court from Ning. 16-8.
She changed her mind about three times there. Followed it in, easy kill.
17-8.
See it here, look at her stepping up after the defensive shot, so aggressive. Yeah, enjoyed that one.
18-8.
Kim Min-jun just running out of ideas, I think. It's a couple of easy errors, getting a little frustrated.
Area. And now just 2 points away from this opening game. Now 1 point away. In a pinnacle performance so far by the world champions.
Game point, 8.
Seven straight points to close out the game in just 14 minutes of play.
First game won by one was for me, Yu Young, 21-8.
Yes, Koreans started that game. They had a good game plan, working really hard, good long rallies, very competitive the first half of that game. Second half of the game, when the Chinese just upped the tempo a little bit, you could see the confidence ebbing away from the Korean girls, really running out of ideas, getting frustrated, making mistakes on return of serve. Always a sure indication that, you know, frustration creeping in.
Well, I would have thought the instructions from the Chinese coaches would be very simple. More of that, please.
Yeah, probably more motivational. Telling them to keep the intensity high, keep the pressure on their opponents, not let them in the game. As you say, a couple of times this year, the Koreans have been able to sneak a set off them. I'm sure the coaches want them to be clinical in this second game and not relax.
Second game, level play.
So, having taken the opening game in double quick time, the defending champions.
Service over.
And
Wang Xiaoli
taking that opening game 21-8. Well, wonder if Kim Min-soo had been able to give any instructions that are going to make a dramatic difference in this second.
They're just being forced onto the defence the whole time. They're being driven away from the net position. And it's just survival. Yeah, well placed, powerful smash.
Oh,
defence, but she was just driven back again. In the end, forced to put up the defensive lift. And the attack's just too good for them at the moment.
Side that time it was across the body towards her right hip.
Yeah,
that's a good return of serve.
Try and step up in defence, trying to counter and use the drive defence, a little bit more positive. A little bit unlucky there, there was a lot of space, just missed it. Concerted effort at the moment to try and step up and take some risks on defence, try and counter-attack.
Leon Day watching this, a little bit embarrassed that the cameras were on him. Leon Day, of course, men's doubles specialist, lost in the semi-final yesterday. I say specialist, he's an excellent mixed doubles player because, of course, he's the Olympic mixed doubles champion. Playing men's doubles here in these finals. Too flat, it's gone long.
Well left, good reactions four from five. Kim.
Not really wanting Yu Yang to tell down.
On. Very often in ladies' doubles you see the rear court player will stay behind her partner, but not Wang Xiaoli. She looks to cover the other side of the court, steps up. It's a really good combination. The line judge and says no, it was out. I wouldn't mind seeing that again. Well, the Chinese players aren't happy. Yeah, they're both, well, Yu Yang's looking up to the giant screen, hoping for a replay.
5-7.
That doesn't look as though we're going to see it.
Five.
Umpire has to be 100% sure that a clear error's been made.
And of course, that's the far side of the court from where we're sitting. Well, we don't have a clear view either. Short. Ah. Channel attack. involved. Wang Xiaoli put this one away. That was tremendous.
Made it look easy, but it's not. That was coming quickly. She was a couple of metres away from the net, which makes it more awkward. Very efficient finish.
Well, since forming their partnership, Wang Xiaoli and Yu Yang, is their 18th individual tournament and their 17th final. It's just astonishing, isn't it? And as I said earlier, the only time they didn't reach the final was when Wang Xiaoli got carried off court in the first round of the 2010 China Open. In the middle of the first game, she went down injured.
Able to get through this Chinese pair, creating one or two good attacking opportunities. They're not able to convert. And when the Chinese retake the attack, they're so clinical with it. Space straight, tried to change the direction, but it was too late. Total missed time.
Trying to do the right thing, but ending up in error. And that means that in game number two, we have a 6-point advantage. All the world champions and defending Super Series finals champions.
Yes, they're in full flow at the moment, aren't they? Solid in defence, clinical in attack. It's really difficult to see that the Koreans can change tactically. Had a little bit of success at the start of that game, just stepping up in defence, trying to be aggressive, but the Chinese have adjusted their attack, going more to the centre to prevent the Koreans counter-attacking.
Wonderful demonstration of that. Release the grip, and as you were about to hit the shuttle, tighten the grip again. That's generating all the power. It's long as the back line, though.
Service over 6-11.
A little bit too big the swing, but doesn't miss many. That's a good
shot. 11.
Change of pace. Also going out to the sideline.
Fantastic.
Same pattern as the first game, the Chinese just upping the pace a little bit after the mid-game interval, 14, pulling away. Seven. Good reactions. The partner really quick in, not allowing the Korean block.
As you've said again, it's not as if the Koreans are playing badly. The Chinese are just absolutely superb.
Service over.
Oh, it's a real demonstration, eight, isn't it? 15. Attacking ladies' doubles play.
Hit and then immediately move forward. Wow, 2-10.
Service over.
Missed it, but again, nine, it was set up well for it.
16.
To backhand with good pace, and the Chinese defense was equal to it. They're lethal.
When I first saw them play team up together, I thought they were impressive, but to be honest, Ian, I think they're still improving. They're still getting better and better.
10-18.
Quite clearly the number one pair in the world.
Oh, I think they are. I think they're definitely getting better. Combination plays are getting better, the rotation around the court. Everything's moving forward the whole time. What's great to see is that they're using their strengths to play an aggressive game, and as you've said many times, Jill, hopefully other pairs will follow and we'll see a more aggressive type ladies doubles emerging from this. People can't stand and defend against them, so they're gonna have to try and compete with them on attack.
It's going wide. Said it one of the first Super Series events this year, Ian. Thought there was a distinct possibility that this Chinese combination were going to take women's doubles to a new level. I think it's already happened.
What we need now is some of the other pairs to follow.
Definitely.
But there's a big gap at the moment between number one and the rest. That's the problem.
19.
Good flick serve.
Well, not even a net cord gets through. Great reactions.
Well,
this one went 19. Out. It's so difficult to win points off them.
Yan wanted the shuttle changed. Kim Ming Jung says no. Umpire agrees with the Koreans.
Service over.
Forced into error. And now 8 match points.
Match point for Wang Xiaoli
and Yu Yang. Moments of victory, retain the title they won from the 2010 Super Series finals. In that competition, they beat the world number twos in the final Taipei pair this year. Well, they've disposed of the world number fours in double quick time. There is confirmation of their victory. 21-8. 21-12. Well, we'll have the prize presentation for the women's doubles in just a moment. So that's the first of our five finals at the Super Series finals complete. Next up will be the defending champions and world champions in the mixed doubles, Zhang Nan and Zhao Yunlei, up against the current world number two, Zhu Chen and Ma Jin. Then the defending champions in the men's doubles with Matthias Bo and Carsten Mogensen of Denmark, only Europeans involved on finals day. They're up against the home players, Chai Biao and Guo Zhendong. Then women's singles and the world number one, Wang Yihan, up against Saina Nehwal of India. Saina Nehwal, of course, missed last year's end of season championships because of an ankle injury. And then our fifth and final at the Super Series finals will be men's singles with the world and Olympic champion, Lin Dan. So plenty to look forward to coming up. But before our second final, we have the prize presentation for the women's doubles. So the prize presentation for the women's doubles. Very fitting that the title won by the world number ones and the BWF female badminton players of the year. Well, Ian, you were talking about the fact that other pairs have got to follow the style of Yu Yang and Wang Xiaoli and play a more aggressive style. I have to say, the pair that won Group B, the Danes, two Danes of Camilla Rutte-Jung and Christina Pedersen, they have indeed tried to play a very aggressive game and use their height, use their attacking capabilities as best they can throughout the tournament, and they were awarded with a semi-final place. We're going to have a presentation to the tournament referees and officials, but yeah, just tell me a little bit more about the Danish combination, which are relatively new on the world stage.
Yes, well, they're both, of course, world-class mixed doubles players, which gives them a good base for an aggressive game. Both of them tall, both of them powerful athletes. So they've actually got the makings of a very, very good ladies doubles pair. In the past, they've both prioritised the mixed doubles, and now they're starting to train a little bit harder and work a little bit harder for the ladies doubles event. And they're beginning to become a very, very dangerous pair. As you say, particularly in some of the quicker balls, their attacking play is being rewarded with some really outstanding results at the moment.
Yes, well, it's good as well for the future of women's doubles. But I have to say, Yu Yang and Wang Xiaoli turning into a bit of a phenomenon at the moment.
Hope is that some of the other top nations will be studying what's happening and start to adapt their training a little bit. Still Japanese pairs, Korean pairs a little bit, still playing a very safe, solid game, happy to start on defense. You're going to look at what's happening at the top of the game and start to try and evolve more attacking styles of play, more attacking training sessions.
Yes, indeed. I think it's inevitable. I think they have to. The way singles has developed, and now women's singles players using jump smashes, which the men have been using for years, and you know, all of a sudden you get the Chinese came into world badminton in the early 80s and they changed women's singles, and for a long while nobody could compete against them. They've remained incredibly strong in women's singles, but you know, other players now, other nations, Thailand, Taipei, India, have all got youngsters in the women's singles that are coming up, but will be, if not now, in the very near future, real challenges. So other nations have learnt in women's singles, so one assumes they're going to learn in women's doubles as well.
Yes, possibly the gap's a little bit bigger in the ladies doubles event, but certainly, as you're saying, ladies singles, there's a great crop of young talent coming through at the moment. There really is. Mentioned some of the nations, I've had Japan to that. We've got some excellent junior players coming through in ladies singles at the moment.
Yeah, it's interesting you bring up Japan, because of course in the top eight in the world there's four Japanese pairs in the women's doubles, but Japanese women's doubles don't tend to be this aggressive style that we've witnessed in today's final. They are far more defensive in their style of play.
Yeah, but it's interesting here because the Danish pair, as we've explained, are playing a more aggressive style now, disposed comfortably of the top two Japanese pairs here. So hopefully Japan will go away and have a look at that.
So to the prize presentation for the women's doubles and the champions for the second consecutive year, Wang Xiaoli and Yu Yang. Wang Xiaoli and Yu Yang, their 14th title together in only their 18th tournament together. him. Well, have to settle for second best. As they pose for the photographers, we're left to wonder who on earth can challenge the dominance of Wang Xiaoli and Yu Yang. They've had the most wonderful year. 13 finals from 13 individual tournaments played. Winning